Hi, everybody. Welcome back. I think we just got on the Twitch front page. So for those of you who are coming in and a little bit curious about what the heck we're doing here, this is the AWS New York Summit. So AWS is Amazon Web Services, and we provide a series of really, really fun and cool tools and APIs for any kind of IT you can imagine. So servers or machine learning or data transform, all that good stuff. And what we do at this New York Summit is it's a primarily educational event, but we also announce a couple of new features. And so we're here talking live about all those new features and kind of covering a lot of different opportunities to talk to product owners, people who are responsible for building those services and developing them, and also talking to some of our customers. So today I have the distinct privilege of being with AM, who's a technical evangelist on our team at AWS, and we're also here with Kevin from Cox Automotive.
Oh. And you so, are?
Yeah.
You are?
Oh, I'm Randall Hunt, and I'm just a dude that they somehow
allowed up here. He's always here.
I'm just a software engineer. They're probably going to kick me off stage in like 5 more minutes. So could you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit more about your company and also sure. How you guys use AWS?
Yeah, so my name is Kevin Thorley. I'm an enterprise architect at Cox Automotive. Cox Automotive is a pretty large service provider in the automotive space. We run some consumer-facing capabilities that people are familiar with. Autotrader.com, Kelley Blue Book are two of the big ones. And then a lot of services used by dealerships and others in the automotive industry, financial services, dealer management services. One of the largest auto auctions in the world. So pretty wide assortment of capabilities and interesting workloads that we're actually in the process of moving to AWS now.
That's awesome. Maybe you can't tell us, but I'm curious. What's the scale that you guys operate at? If you were to choose a metric, whether it's requests per second or gigabytes and terabytes of data, I'm just curious. What's something kind of meaty that you could?
Across the organization, it varies. We do some advertising capabilities within the digital marketing space, where we deal with 400,000 requests per second, I believe, in that system. So well over a billion a day. That's on the advertising space. One of the content management platforms for dealerships is about 15,000 dealer websites on a single platform. Like I said, one of the largest auto auctions in the country. So we've got scale in many different directions, physical scale, virtual request per second scale.
Awesome.
And all those requests, it's probably apropos that we're talking about serverless today, right?
Yes.
So it's my understanding that you guys take a little bit of advantage of a feature that I have been asking for literally 4 years, and I promised the PM of the feature that I would name my firstborn child Lambda if we actually launched. That was 4 years ago. So that is SQS, which is Simple Queue Service, as an event source for Lambda. And what this means is Simple Queue Service is actually our oldest service. I think this was the first AWS service that ever came out. And it used to be XML, or it even had a SOAP adapter at one point. You would make these requests, you would put them in a queue, and it was this kind of infinitely scalable queue service. And when Lambda first came out in 2014, I was like, this is the best possible integration, because now whenever something gets added to my queue, I can consume it. And then in 2018, we actually got the feature, and you guys make use of it, right?
We're starting to, as we go into Q3, we've got a bunch of teams that are starting to write Lambdas with SQS as an event source. And we've been writing Lambdas for a while now, and we've also been using SQS for a while, most of the time not together. There are some cases where we've put them together, we've cobbled them together with various mechanisms. But being able to do it kind of natively out of the box is going to just be so much easier and just fewer decisions to make, right? Today, we get into situations where we have an event. We want to take an event-based approach, and we want to use Lambda, but we couldn't use SQS, so we'll use maybe Kinesis. Maybe we'll use SNS, direct Lambda invocation from one place or the other. And what it ends up being is we're sacrificing. We're needing to write more glue code. We're needing to implement our own retry logic and failure handling, whereas with SQS, you just get that.
Sure. I really like the fact that you get all of the... So the way SQS works is a message comes in and it has You know, it'll sit in the queue until it times out, basically. Yeah. And then when you grab the message from the queue, let's say your Lambda function is consuming that, you can grab up to 10 at a time, I think, because it's the batch. Yep. It's the most you can grab in a single receive call. You grab that message, and you have a visibility timeout on that. So your Lambda function can process that message within the visibility timeout. And yep. if it's successful, the messages are removed from the queue. And there's the Lambda service takes care of that for you. You don't have to worry about it. If it's not successful, the messages are returned to the queue after the visibility timeout. So it's a lot of very powerful components working in the background to enable yeah. you to write very simple code that kind of lets you get stuff done.
And maybe we should step back a little bit too and put into context where SQS fits in a serverless design and what is a serverless design. You know, just kind of high level it a little bit.
I think that you should answer those questions.
I'm setting myself up here. I'm just teeing it up really easy. So serverless, it's a paradigm that was really kind of enabled by Lambda, right? That was really kind of the first time, at least I thought in terms of maybe I don't need a full running server just to respond to a simple event. And SQS fits into this paradigm really well. Because typically you do have a queue of things, right? PubSub is a very, very common pattern that you see a lot in distributed architectures, things like that. So having it sit in a queue and be able to populate an event into a Lambda, again, which the Lambda just runs a block of code, right? Arbitrary block of code that you define, it makes sense. That was an old pattern I've used a lot in my career. You would have RabbitMQ sitting there taking in, right? And you had to make sure that the events were unique, and SQS really helps
and
get rid of.
You had to run RabbitMQ.
The glue code. I like how you put that, the glue code.
But if you do want to run ActiveMQ or the equivalent,
we've got it.
Amazon MQ is there. You can tell it's a product because we put our name in front of it. One of the things, I'll just briefly say, we have had SQS since the beginning of AWS, and it's something that was probably the first service I ever used. And I think SQS kind of holds at its core a lot of the things that inspired the rest of our development for all of the hundreds of services that, 100 plus services that we now have. And those are, you know, you only pay for what you use. In the serverless paradigm, you don't really pay for idle. You kind of get this on-demand contract. I mean, there's no contract. You know, you're not doing this upfront capital expenditure. You don't have to sign any agreements. It's an API. You call it, and it works. And it's a lot easier than trying to like sign some huge enterprise IT deal. So that said, I'd love to hear a little more about serverless architectures at Cox Automotive and all the cool things that you guys are building.
So we started off with Lambda specifically, say maybe 2 years ago. A lot of the use cases were kind of glue code, maybe tying together components within a CI/CD pipeline, continuous integration pipeline, tying together various applications in places where they didn't natively fit together, but we could use Lambda as a bit of glue to facilitate message passing, for instance. Since then, we've been moving more toward replacing existing components and even building new components. So building API endpoints, for example, building the REST API in Lambda, right, as opposed to building it on Beanstalk.
And that's API gateway to Lambda.
In that case, it'd be API gateway with requests coming in, going to the various Lambda functions, usually one function per resource or per method on a resource.
And then how do you guys end up deploying this sort of stuff? So is it, maybe that's a tough question, but I feel like when we deploy, typical questions, typical applications, something on Elastic Beanstalk, for instance, sometimes it's just EB space deploy, sometimes you have a batch script, sometimes you use Jenkins or, all manner of different tools. And then we also have within AWS a set of services, things like code pipeline, code commit, and I forgot what the other, they're all called code something.
Right. And there's SAM now too, right? Yeah. SAM helps with deployment as well.
So do you guys make use of those?
All of them, all of the above. Right.
Yeah, that's awesome.
When we started off, a lot of it was based on Jenkins. We kind of put together a a foundational Jenkins instance, Jenkins image that people could use and then deploy into their accounts and use that for their CI/CD pipelines. Terraform was the choice we made for the infrastructure as code space. And now, as time's moved on, what we found is that those worked really well for deploying, like you said, applications into a Beanstalk instance, whereas Lambda is a different model. And so we're looking at SAM. We've got some teams using Serverless framework for the deployments. And again, always trying to tie the whole thing back to a continuous integration, continuous delivery pipeline.
So you have multiple teams using multiple different frameworks across the company, all using Serverless?
Serverless framework.
No, all using Serverless paradigms. So you have some teams using SAM, some teams using Serverless, some teams using Terraform.
Some teams using Terraform, some teams using CloudFormation. That's
awesome. Sorry. Yeah. That's really, really cool.
It's a lot to keep track of.
Well, we were talking off screen, too, about the various languages.
Yes.
There's a lot of languages at Cox, too.
Right. We cover, we've got some pretty big shops in Java. So I come from dealer.com. That's a big Java shop. Autotrader.com is a big Java shop. But we've got .NET. We've got Python.
Yes.
Ruby. Node.js. We've got RPG. RPG is not going to the cloud anytime soon, but the other languages all are in one shape or another.
What kind of stuff are you guys writing in Python?
We've got some of our...
I didn't see that coming at all.
Actually, some of the teams here in New York are Python-based.
Really?
Some of our financial F&I applications.
Are those kind of like data science?
Nope. Those are... It's a...
Real-time...
A SaaS product used by the dealerships.
Way cool.
Yep.
So, and you guys make use of .NET as well?
We do. We've got .NET teams in a few different places.
Wow. SAM, you said you use SAM, right?
We've started to, yep.
So SAM is something called a CloudFormation Transform. And the way that it works is you have an existing kind of CloudFormation template that can be pretty verbose. So if you look at the way that CloudFormation was before SAM, you would have to specify manually just about everything. And the syntax, first of all, it used to be just JSON.
Yeah, no YAML.
And that was rough. Right. I'll be honest, it was a little rough. A little hard to get through and read and not poke your eyes out. If you ever wanted to like see if you had 20/20 vision, the best way was to like press command -- on your editor for a good hour and then try and see if you could see any of the CloudFormation templates still. So YAML came along, and with YAML, you get this ability to kind of specify things in a slightly less verbose syntax. But then you have SAM. And what happens with SAM is instead of specifying every single event source and event type and all that good stuff, you're going and you're saying, at the end of the serverless function definition, what I want to include is event source DynamoDB, or event source Kinesis, or event source SQS.
Yeah, it's got intelligence around event sources that are expected to power Lambdas.
And it can infer the rest of it and pull it all together for you. So it's one of the advantages of SAM that I've enjoyed. And we have something now called the Serverless Application Repository, where you can actually build out SAM applications, and you can put them into the Serverless App Repo, and then other people can invoke them and instantiate them, which is pretty darn cool.
So with all those, to go back to all those languages at Cox, have you seen developing with serverless and lambdas kind of reduce any friction across teams? Has that helped?
That's a good question. The first thing I've seen teams do is take the languages they're most familiar with and put it into Lambda.
Sure.
So what we've seen is the Java teams running Java on Lambda, and then started to see some cases of people choosing a language more because it's the right fit for a specific problem or has the performance characteristics they want, and being willing to branch out a little bit. It's taken a little bit of time to come from the big monolith mindset into a smaller, functions as a service, basically, right? Getting down to a really small level of granularity and choosing the language that's just right for that one.
Right. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
So you mentioned that you use Terraform as well.
Yep.
And I'm curious, what kind of like tools do you use for kind of tracking development? The thing with serverless is that the unit of code on which you are working is much smaller typically, because you're abstracting everything out to these smaller pieces of code that are just accomplishing some business unit. You're not having to implement a lot of orchestration and like multi-threading and concurrency and all this other stuff, because a lot of it can just be taken care of for you. Although you can, if you want, use threads and Lambda functions. Not important. Anyway, I'm curious, you know, how do you get developers working on the different parts of this infrastructure if you're using, you know, Terraform in one place and SAM in another place and CodeStar or Code Pipeline and Code Deploy and all that stuff in other places?
I think it really comes down to how we structure the teams. And usually, almost always, our teams will own one or more applications, one or more capabilities, and you know, we encourage them to do the things that make sense within their space, right? I personally think there's a lot to be gained by consistency. We can do a lot more sharing when we have consistency. So it might not be the one right solution. It might be the couple solutions that we can choose from that we have enough of a knowledge base across the company to support all of those. But in many cases, you know, the team's building a smaller application, a smaller service, and if it makes sense for them to use SAM and then to use Terraform to handle infrastructure, that works in their space. We also took an approach of, we have a ton of accounts, hundreds of AWS accounts. And you know, every team has a minimum two, a production and non-production, and that's usually per domain, like from a bounded context, like domain-driven design perspective. So a team can have maybe two, four, six accounts, depending on how many applications and services they own. And really, the choices a team makes, they've got a little bit of ability to make a decision, and maybe it's the right one, maybe it's the wrong one, but the, you know, the blast radius is fairly small within that account. And you know, ideally, we're choosing technologies that are somewhat consistent across the organization so we can share that knowledge, again, not have everyone learning the same thing over and over again, but people can still experiment within their space. And as you find teams finding something that works, that's bubbling its way up. We make pretty extensive use of Slack channels. So we've got Slack across the organization.
Do you have chat ops going on? So you have, you know, bots that are notifying anytime a CloudWatch
event
fires?
We've got bots backed by Lambda. And we've actually got some of the AWS SA folks also in our Slack, and they chime in as well, which
nice.
Is great. But yeah, so we've got groups set up where people can just go and ask a question. And chances are, if they ask a question, someone else across the company has dealt with that problem. We've got hundreds of Scrum teams. So we've already built up a lot of knowledge. And that's, you know, we're finding it's easier to have people contribute in that space rather than have the one person to go to, the one place to go to.
So something that's really interesting for me, you mentioned that you have hundreds of AWS accounts, which, one, people may not realize this is true of many larger organizations. This is a reality, is that, you know, kind of having this boundary of separation is the AWS account is powerful. And it also enables developers to be able to make the right sort of decisions about what makes sense for their particular application and their particular domain.
Right.
That said, you are a very large company, or you do work for a very large company, and I'm curious what kind of governance and things you put in place to enable that sort of large scale, large number of accounts.
Yeah, good question. We've got a lot of stuff in place. So first of all, no one creates their own accounts. All the accounts are created by a single group, and that group is then able to tie them all back to the one overall account that we use the account that we use for financial accounting and roll-ups and all that.
It's like the consolidated billing and everything.
Yep. And we rolled this model out a couple years ago, and I know Amazon's got some tools in space now, but we built a tool internally that we called ALKS. And basically, you log into this tool with your internal company credentials, your Active Directory account.
The SAM,
It stands for Airlift Key Services.
Okay.
And so you log in with your Active Directory credentials, and you choose the account that you want, so you get access to some number of accounts, and then you get your credentials and you log into that account. So nobody has long-lived credentials in AWS. Everything is federated, so all users are federated. All users.
Even on the CLI?
Yes.
Oh, that's so cool.
So we've got a CLI client for ALKS, we've got a browser plugin for ALKS. You log in using that tool, whether it's in CLI, whether it's in the browser, they want the console, whatever. So from the CLI, log in, execute Terraform. We've got limitations specifically around IAM, so we can't do privilege escalation. But yeah, there's a lot of governance in place around that.
Well, I would talk to you about this for probably hours because there are some really amazing and cool things in the multi-account governance situation. We have IAM boundary permissions that just got released. It didn't get a lot of press, but it's probably one of the most important features that we've launched in a while. It's like control over sudo within your IAM. Unfortunately, we do have a ton of other content today, so we're going to go on to our next section.
All right.
But thank you so much for coming on stage and talking about this. It was really fantastic to hear from a customer. So thanks again.
Thanks for the invite.
I hope to see you again at reInvent.
Great. Thanks a lot, guys.
We'll be right back.